Hey everyone, welcome to Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogeo Power Sports and Yamaha Motorsports. I don't even need to introduce Ryan Hughes, but thanks for coming on. I was cracking up yesterday when I, or the other day when I asked you if you wanted to come on.
Yeah.
And you're like, I was just watching a show. I'm wondering when the fuck I was going to get my invitation.
Yeah, no, I was watching there because sometimes I sit on YouTube and I'll just flip through things. And then you had something, so I was watching and I'm like, you know what? Maybe he just doesn't like me. You know what I mean? Maybe he just doesn't like me. I don't know. He's not going to have me on his show. So, you know, I was kind of like, well, you know, screw him. And then all of a sudden the next day, there's a text. I'm like, now that's weird.
You know what I mean? Right?
So, but I've always, like say, I've always wanted to come on your show. Uh-huh. You know, I've digged that your passion for the sport, your interest for the sport. You've been in it for so long. And, you know, that's the people that I like to be around, attract to, not just the people who are trying to get something from the sport, mm-hmm. actually give to the sport. And that's what I see in you. So it's cool.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Dude, I was driving here this morning. I was thinking about I can remember the day I met you the first time. Barona Oaks, this is a CMC Golden State, KX125 Dalmatian JT gear.
Yeah.
And I think you won the pro class or something, but I was like, came to interview you afterwards and, talk to you. You had braces.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty funny that I can remember the day I met you.
Oh,
you
wow.
know, and then the years, all the years of your career, all the things you did, you know, for my own concussions and stuff, some of it's foggy, but like I have things that stand out, right?
Yeah.
So I was thinking, as we texted, I'm like, dude, you and I are gonna have so much to talk about, we're gonna have to do two shows.
Yeah, no doubt.
Okay. So to start off, like, I wanna just ask you questions about things that I remember, right?
Okay.
So maybe not in any specific order mm-hmm. either, but you were like one of the first guys to race a factory four-stroke in Europe, right? The Honda on the...
Not in Europe, here.
Was it here? It was here. Okay, yeah.
So I was in Europe and I did the 99 and 2000 World Championships then.
Mm-hmm.
And
Pomo Honda.
Yeah. Was having some issues with them with payment. You know, I didn't get paid all year. At the end of the year, you know, they paid me everything. So, you know, kudos to Paul Casper. And but then Honda was like, hey, we're coming out with this 450. We want to bring you back to the United States and develop it and race just the nationals. And I was like, well, cool. I can come back to the States. You know, it was good money. I had just had a baby girl, all these things. Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. But I don't think it was the best decision in my life. Maybe I have two ones that weren't the best, you know, and that was one of them just because I feel like I should have finished out my career in Europe. Mm-hmm. I had a good thing going. There's a lot of teams that wanted me. I liked Europe. I dig the flow. I dig the people. I dig the you know, just how different it is. You know, each
country. Yeah, it's funny because your personality probably is perfect for that. Like a lot of Americans go to Europe and like, oh, dude, it's so hard, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
You're adaptable and you probably enjoyed all the cultures and everything.
Yeah, a lot of people have, you know, blinders on. A lot of people just have to make it one way. And I'm a very creative person. I like diversity. I like, you know, newness. And that's when I kind of perform my best or feel like I'm most comfortable when there's insecurity in my life. Mm-hmm. And so I should have stayed there and finished out, but they came back, did that. The bike wasn't, I don't think it was ready to race. Mm-hmm. Or just life had a different plan for me to throw me on the ground a lot.
Yeah, was it, you crashed a lot that year, right?
Yeah.
Was it the bike didn't work well, or was it just like the bike was so powerful and different than what you'd raced?
Well, a few of the big crashes happened that in the air, you know, I'd jump up and I'd hit the back brake and the bike would stall.
Yeah.
And that's a scary feeling. Yeah. When the bike stalled and you can't get out and you're just dead sailor, not a dead sailor because you don't even give it gas.
Yeah.
And you're just watching the ground come to you. And I had some big crashes to the point where I retired for a year. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought, okay, I'm done. I can't do this. This isn't worth it, you know? And so I retired for a year, had the Lloyd's of London thing. But that's when 9/11 happened. And they went through everything, and then each year you got to put down your injuries, right? Mm-hmm. And so I had a lot of concussions that year, so I put down my injuries, and they went back and they go through each year and they combine, you know, they compare them. Mm-hmm. And they came up with one. They said, well, if you had this, if we knew about this one that you mentioned here, but you didn't mention this year, we wouldn't have covered you. I'm like,
oh,
interesting. Man. But that's when, because I just got bombarded by the World Trade Center, right?
Yeah.
And so they said, we're going to give you your you know, premium back, but we're not giving you your bonus. And so I was like, holy shit. So I started testing for KTM that year.
Yeah.
I was working with Lilinovich and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And we're at the track kind of right by my house. And I was turned out to be 4 to 5 seconds a lap faster than Langston and Lilinovich, just testing.
Yeah.
And they're like,
you need a race.
Would you want to race maybe the Nationals? And I'm like, you know what? Funny thing is the insurance just dropped me. And so, yeah, I'm able to race. Mm-hmm. And so why not? You know, and so things like that turn out to be some of the best things in your life, because mm-hmm. I got to race for another 4 or 5 years, make kind of a bit more money and experience and be able to have, you know, stories and experiences that I wouldn't have had just collecting a big check and sitting on the couch and mm-hmm. getting fat and going, okay, cool, life's done. No,
yeah.
No. You know what I mean? It's almost like if I have too much, it's not good for me. I need to have that fight. I need to have that uncertainty. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? And that keeps me alive every day. You know,
yeah.
when things become too monotonous or too kind of comfortable, I'm dangerous to myself.
You get complacent. Yeah. Hey, when you retired, you know, off the Honda, was that when you got like super buff?
Yeah.
Right? Because
yeah.
I remember I saw you at Quinn Helen yeah. and I was all, damn, Ryno, you look like the Hulk. And you're like, eh. Can't do it when you're riding, so I might as well do it now. But you're just like yoked out.
Yeah, I mean, I met a friend, and you know, he did tile business or whatever, and then he was at the gym. So we just went to the gym like 5 days a week. You know, I'm like, well, shit, I never could get big. I never could lift a lot of weight. So we just did it for a damn year.
Uh-huh.
You know, so I got to about 190, I think. You know, I'm about 170, 175. So I got about 190, almost 200, and then when KTM was like, hey, do you want to race? I was like, well, yeah. So then
they leaned out,
stripped down to 170, because that's usually my weight. My racing weight is about 170, mm-hmm. 175, and so yeah. Because again, you see a lot of riders do that. They kind of go, you know what? I want to get kind of big. You know what I mean? Or they get into something different.
Dude, I swear your voice got lower too.
No.
Yeah.
No. I never used any.
No. I'm just saying.
Never used anything. Yeah.
You just got so big. It's like the perception was your voice is low. I was like, damn, dude. You're
the
big.
Voice is deeper from something else. No.
Yeah. So, okay. So then another thing that stands out is that real famous motocross action picture of you pushing your KX towards the finish line with a broken chain.
Yeah.
Right? That personifies you, right? Like, never give up, always try. But, like, what went through your mind when that happened?
Well, I get that question a bit, and you know what? Nothing went through my mind. Nothing went through my mind, and that's why it's so strange to me, because it happened for a reason. It was meant to happen. I know it. There's so many things in my life, from even being paralyzed or divorced to all these things, even ugly things. They're gems, you know what I mean? And so when I cased that jump and turned the corner and gave it gas and the bike just spun, nothing happened, I looked down and the chain was off. Okay, well, the checker flag's over there. You got to get to it mm-hmm. somehow. Well, you push your bike.
Yeah.
So I never even thought about what should I do? Oh, screw! Oh, this sucks. Fuck the bike. Poor mm-hmm. me. Oh, the championship's over. No, my dad taught me you don't stop till you see the checker flag, son.
Mm-hmm.
And so I didn't see it. And so I just pushed it up. And, you know, if I wasn't going to win the championship, well, that was the best thing that ever could have happened, because not too many people wouldn't remember who won the championship, but that will go down in motocross history.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of cool, because I would much rather have maybe the money, but I'd much rather have that than a number one plate, because that number one plate never motivated anybody, never changed anybody's life. I have a lady that sent me a picture, and she said she was on her deathbed. They said you had 3 months left to live, and she was watching motocross. She wasn't really a motocross fan, and she saw me pushing my bike to the mm-hmm. line, and she said that inspired her so much that she lived for another 10, 12 years.
Oh, wow.
Yes. I mean, unbelievable. So every time she'd get down, she'd just say, push the bike, push the bike, push the bike, you know? And
She was able to find you and let
you
know.
And she sent me pictures and this, and I have this thing on my wall of that picture of what she wrote to me.
Mm-hmm.
And so to me, that means a lot more to me, that I can inspire people mm-hmm. instead of just impress people.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? Because I don't feel like I came down to this earth to just impress people by how I can ride a motorcycle. I like to inspire people and also, you know, teach people, you know, mm-hmm. share with people my experiences from this whole sport. And I get a joy at it, man. I really do.
Yeah. So. Cool. Ryan, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more with Ryan Hughes. Hey everyone, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by OGO Power Sports and Yamaha Motorsports, here with the legend Ryan Hughes. So we were talking about a few things that stood out to me, right?
Yeah.
The one thing I always was like wondering is when I watch on social media, so I was like, when did Ryno become such a philosopher, right? Because I remember dealing with you like when you were on Factory Cow and stuff, yeah. And it's just you're just like, you give me the quotes or whatever, right? But like, when did you evolve into the person you are now?
I don't know. You know, everybody has their roads. Everybody has their you know, destination. And if you are too close-minded, then maybe you don't ever see your true gift mm-hmm. or your true, you know, reason of being here. And so, again, after that time, I retired and then came back, and then I kind of got done with motocross, went into some outdoor off-road racing into the works, and just kind of started just reading, you know, just reading a lot of stuff and reading a lot of stuff. And then I just remember, you know, I started getting into meditation and things, and I just remember just saying, all right, you know, because to me, there's a universal mind of everything, of motocross, of this, is of all this information that we think about, you know, mm-hmm. kind of, to me, collects in a spot. And so I just, he said, hey, the universal mind, you know, just give me all the information you need to give so I can help the sport, so mm-hmm. I can change the sport. I'm going to change the sport on how it rides because the technique is incorrect. Mm-hmm. And so from that point, it just seems like I just got downloaded with all this stuff. And then that kind of just starts to feed over here and feed over there and feed over there. You start to read this and then that, you know what I'm saying? And it just... Mm-hmm. I don't know, or I got hit on the head too many times. But
those concussions are a bitch.
One of the two, but you know, I do a lot of reading, you know, and stuff like that. I have a very, one of my favorite things is just sit there and ponder. Mm-hmm. I love to ponder. I love to see where my mind goes. I love to be able to analyze things, dissect things, you know, and understand things to a very fine point. And maybe that's where it comes. You know, maybe it came out more as I started being a coach. Mm-hmm. Because I had to start understanding why people are doing this yeah. and how to fix it. Because so many people in the sport and coaches and our trainers just want to tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. But there's not too many people or anybody that gives you a technique of how to do it. And so that takes a lot of thinking, a lot of understanding of how to dissect it and explain it in a very simple manner to people. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because I got to teach kids, yeah. I got to teach vets, and I got to teach pros, and I teach beginners, all with the same philosophy, but just in a different approach. And so a lot of times I learn more teaching the slower guys, the vets or the kids, because I got to figure out why they're doing something so incorrect mm-hmm. and how to fix it. You know yeah. what I mean? And not just try to tell them to go faster. So I think it's just a combination of everything that, you know, you just keep growing, you know, you yeah. keep growing. And if you don't keep kind of, you know, tasting different flavors, well, then you don't ever know, you know, anything new.
Yeah. Right? You know, what's funny is there's plenty of riders that haul ass, right? Like through the years, you know, at the different magazines I work for, we've done these like riding tip stories and stuff. It's pretty mind-blowing how many guys are world-class, right? You go, hey, look at this picture of you going through this corner. Like, can you explain technique? And they can't.
Yeah.
They just do it second nature, right?
Yeah.
So it takes a certain person to be able to break down the riding process and be able to convey it to somebody else. Mm-hmm. Was that something you had to develop, or is that something you've always had, like, to be able to explain stuff?
I've always had time for people. You know, so that's one thing. So when people come and ask me questions, then I'd always have time for them and talked as much as I knew. Mm-hmm. But again, the more you do something, the more you study something, the more you know about something, the more interested you are in it. And then you start to look at and find different things, I guess. I don't think I came here to entertain people on a motorcycle. I feel that I came here to educate people on this new way of riding, because just like I did that race in Loretta's and I had to ride in 1986. Well, that technique is so much different that that bike is asking of you than the new four strokes. Mm-hmm. And that, the new four strokes are asking for a new way of riding, and that's what I've been teaching for the last 12 years. And so to have that ability to, you know, dissect it and explain it, you know, it's a gift.
Yeah.
It's a gift. And so if somebody gives me a gift, well, then why wouldn't I want to give it to everybody else? And that's kind of why, you know, I have that ability to do that. And it's very, it's very interesting. You know, it's very fun for me to, like, to have someone on the track and go, okay, no, I've never seen this. Okay, hold on. You know what I mean? But sometimes I get that.
Yeah.
And I got to try to have a way to for them to understand. And then I ask them, so what do you do in life? Oh, I do this and this. Okay. Well, then I have a way to kind of compare it.
Yeah.
And, you know, a different
relatable
comparison. Yeah. And, to it. And then they kind of get it. And I don't know. I guess when you have fun with something, then you become more creative with it, right? And you become more interested in it. And that's why I guess I have that ability, you know?
Yeah.
And I feel that the whole, you know, not patting myself on the back, but the whole sport is following the way that I've been teaching. Because it's not, so I'm not pulling anything out of my butt. The bike's been designed one way, the body's been designed one way to work, but I have the ability to understand physics, and I don't even know how physics, but of man and machine kind of better than most and be able to explain it. So I guess I just enjoy it.
Yeah. Okay, so you've been doing the coaching thing some right when you retired, right? You started doing that. You've worked with like a lot of guys that have gone on to be very successful. Most notable in my head is like Eli Tomac, but have there been others like that stand out to you?
Yeah, I mean, I've talked to Tomac. You know, I've worked with Josh Hill, Jason Lawrence, Glenn Goldenhoff. I've had many talks with Ryan Dungey, you know, Barsha, Trey Kennard. You know, I talk to everybody, you know what I mean? Because I'm not afraid to talk to anybody, and I'm not afraid to tell somebody that they could be better. Like even Dungey, when I saw him, hey, dude, you don't use your feet. I go, what do you mean? And I told him, and then after a while, he came back after we talked. He said, my God, you're right. I don't use my feet. And there was a huge difference in his riding. You know, I just had a talk with with Barsha before Southwick about how they, you know, I see Dylan rolling the bike, rolling this. And then when I was working with Noah that day, he had a really good day, and it was that roll into the corners, that feel in the corners. And I had a talk with Barsha about some things like that. And then Southwick, he got third the next race, and he won. Not because of me, but maybe just I sparked something in him to go, ah, you're right. And that's all sometimes we need, you know, especially at that level, is someone just to be able to see something small, because that's what it is, for them to change a different approach. But it takes, you know, somebody to look at the sport differently. But if I'm trying to protect a paycheck, if I'm trying to protect a job, if I just want to hang around people that have a name, you know what I mean? Or if I'm trying to protect a persona, then I'm going to be very limited on what I say and what I do and what I look at. But for me, I have nobody owns me. Zero. I make my own money. I have no employees, you know what I mean? I don't have any sponsors, and I make that a reason. And I don't give two shits what people think of me. So that's why I can speak to anybody, you know, very, very bluntly and honestly, you know? So, and that's why, this is why I don't hold my tongue in the sport. I don't care to lose one friend to help a million people.
Yeah.
And I've told people in the sport, I said, hey, careful, because I don't care to lose you as a friend to be able to tell the truth to a million people in this sport. Because that the sport is my family. The sport, I've done it for 38 years, man. You know, 38 years I have fucking dedicated obsessively of this sport.
Yeah.
And so that means a lot to me.
Yeah.
So.
Cool. Hey, one more quick commercial break. We'll be back for more with Ryno. We'll be right back.
It's hard to put our adventures on hold, but now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products, and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Hey guys, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and Yamaha Motorsports here with Ryan Hughes. You know, it's funny, the last time you were talking before the break, it's like, I don't care about offending people, I tell the truth or whatever. This dumb memory popped into my head, right? Remember you had the signature Bell helmet?
Yeah.
The green, silver and gold.
Yeah, and
it said Ryno on the side, right? Yeah. I remember I was with you in the pit somewhere and some kid comes up to get your autograph and you know, they always want a couple extra seconds, right? He's like, okay, I got a question for you. My name's Brian, right? My name's Brian. I have your replica helmet. It says Ryno on it. What do you think if I added a B so it said Brino? And you're all, that's the dumbest thing I ever heard.
Did I say
that? Yeah, it was the best.
The dumbest thing I've heard.
I was just cracking up. Yeah.
Yeah. Brino. So, no, we're not Brono.
Yeah, Brono. Yeah. So,
pretty honest. Pretty honest guy. You know?
Changing the theme of things a little bit, like that signature helmet, right?
Yep.
That's pretty sick, right? You had a helmet that people bought that wanted to look like you, right? And and yours was a huge personalized signature helmet because it had a 5 on one side and Ryno on the other side. But like, have there been other things to your career, like signature type things that you're real proud of?
Yeah, definitely. You know, that one was cool because I designed the helmet myself.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. Okay. I designed the helmet myself and did that. You know, we've had these motorcycles that were cool, you know, gear come out. And but we never, you know, I don't know if I really... I guess, you know, the biggest thing is just my supplement company, you know what I mean? To be able to have a name on it and to see it around the world.
Yeah.
And see it on the best riders in the world and in all these countries and stuff like that. That's you know, sometimes you got to take a step back and look at what you've done or look at how, you know, the magnitude of it. Mm-hmm. And so it's pretty cool that two guys like myself and Ryan did that. And so I would say stuff like that, you know, not something somebody just made, a keychain or whatever, but you know, it's been fun. I guess the biggest thing, it's still kind of funny to me that people look at me as like a hero, you know what I mean? It's it baffles me. And I always tell people, I say, hey, careful, don't put me on a pedestal, man. Mm-hmm. I go, you probably do 10 things better than I do at one thing. Just that one thing that I do gets recognition, you know? So let's just keep ourselves level. And now, you know, people, oh man, you're so badass. I go, but you're looking at me in the rearview mirror. You know, I'm not that guy. I'm not the racer anymore. That guy's dead. Mm-hmm. You know, if you want to look at me, look at the coach, look at what I'm trying to do for the sport, how much I'm trying to educate it or help it. That's what I want to be seen as, not the racer. That's, if you're looking at life at 50 as you did at 25, you freaking missed it, man. Right?
Yeah.
You missed it. And too many people in the sport are still trying to be 25. Mm-hmm. A lot of old guys still trying to be racers on different things and sponsors. And I'm like, the fuck? You know, it's strange to me.
Yeah.
So I'm not mentioning names, but yeah.
Okay, you brought up Ryno Power, right?
Yes, sir.
Since you retired, you've had several brands or businesses, right? Like, I remember you had the Ryno Gym and the video series that people could subscribe to. And then before Ryno Power, didn't you have like nutrition, like nuts and stuff like that?
Mm-hmm.
So I remember that. And then Ryno Power, but Ryno Power is the thing that stuck.
Yeah.
And been the most successful, right? So it's you and Ryan McCarthy, two Ryans.
Mm-hmm.
What was the inspiration for that? And
Well, the thing is I met Ryan at my, when I had Ryno Land, and yeah, you know, I've had a lot of little things to Ryno Land, and it just seems like I start these things and then it just comes issues with people like the Indians, you know, or it was just issues. So mm-hmm. I was like, you know what, it's time to pull out. And then Paula opened up, mm-hmm. right? So that took a lot of business. Then one of my good friends just fucking bought, Kawea, and I'm like, really, bud? You couldn't, like, you know, so weird things like this. So that was done. Then we started, you know, Ryno Organics because I met somebody that had packaged trail mix and mm-hmm. Chocolate almonds and on almonds, and it was amazing, mm-hmm. you know, but just it was hard for to sell food. You get yeah. what I'm saying? This and that. So that kind of faded away. And then I met Ryan out at my place, and because he was doing some video, and then we started talking. I said, hey, man, I need some help because I have some ideas. And went through some ideas, and then I came up with one, you know, not came up, but I had to go, look, I have this supplement company. I have these supplements mm-hmm. that I've already got from this guy that I've been using for years. He's just some engineer, triathlete guy, makes his own stuff, but doesn't really have time to sell it. But we can start with this. And I have a name for it, and I have a tagline for it, this and that. And he says, yeah, let's do it. Let's mm-hmm. do it. And I said, okay, but I can't put any money into it because if I do, my wife will divorce me, mm-hmm. you know, because I've so many different things. And he's all right. He's like, I'll put 10 grand in. I said, shit, let's go. And so we started mm-hmm. the company with 10 grand.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then we started Ryno Power Gym, which is still going, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I have Ryno equipment, which is these foot pegs and stuff like that. Just, it's hard for me to try to promote everything, coach everything, do everything, build my property out there. So sometimes the other side of these things that I do with people, they don't have the motivation I do. Mm-hmm. You know, then sauna company, you know, with Danielle. Because I really believe in these, you know, these saunas, these far infrareds, and mm-hmm. detoxing yourself. So these are things. It's just I have these great ideas. I have these roads. I know how to get there. I'm just not good with the little things, man.
Yeah.
I'm just not good with the little things.
Your mind's always going a million miles.
Yeah. I don't own a computer.
Yeah.
I don't
really
own a, zero. I don't okay. own a computer. No, nothing. You know, I don't yeah. search webs and shit. So I'm just a different person that way. And but. If you have an idea, I can give you a road. Mm-hmm. If I come into a place, I can see exactly what's wrong with it, but then I'll make somebody else do the little things.
Yeah, yeah.
But I love the little things of training and coaching and doing, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a, sometimes I confuse myself.
Okay, so you named off several other things. Ryno Equipment, yep. Was that the bike trainer?
Yep, yeah, the bike trainer and the foot pegs. So the reason I came up with the bike trainer is like I would come to, let's say I coached you guys and I come to a track and I want you guys, let's say you guys were wearing neck braces for so long and you had these weird techniques of being behind the bike and now I need you to come forward on this motorcycle almost like 2 feet forward with your mm-hmm. head and your upper body. Well, that's gonna feel very, you're gonna be able to do it on a fixed service, you know, on a motorcycle not moving. But now if I put a double, a whoop, a jump, a rut, a bump in front of you, you're gonna go back probably to what's conditioned because there's a consequence in front of this uncertainty, mm-hmm. right? But if I can put you on a stand that moves around, well, now you can understand where you are on the motorcycle, find out technically, and then do these things repetition-wise, mm-hmm. and then hopefully that will come out on the track when it means something. Or if you have to work all the time, you can come home and, you know, put a video on or whatever and go through these exercises mm-hmm. so then like you're not just riding on the weekend and so pissed off because half the day you're just dealing with arm pump. You know, you have a little bit of muscle memory.
Yeah.
People back east, same thing. I always thought it'd be the best thing on earth for Tomac, GoPro, around yeah. the Supercross track, right? Okay, right before, 20 minutes before the race comes, they have that GoPro on a TV. We've done it before. You put the motorcycle here and you do the track. Bah, 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 bah. Mm-hmm. You go through it, you'll create a sweat. All right, time to go. Boom, you jump off that, get on the bike you just warmed up on. I see all these guys on rowing machines, looking around, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
On bicycles that are stuck to the ground. You know, back tuck, buck rounded. Which Tour de France guy goes running? You know, which yeah. soccer player plays baseball to
yeah,
warm up?
Yeah.
Our sport does things incorrectly, I think, to warm up. And you're asking your body to perform like a cat, but you just warmed up like a salamander.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning you're on a rowing machine stuck to the ground in a really bad position. You're on a bicycle stuck to the ground. So if you had a motorcycle that you could go while you're following the track and you're putting that track in your mind, blah, 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 I feel that would be the best warm up ever. So that's yeah. why I created that. But it,
yeah.
it became kind of a big bulky thing. Mm-hmm. And then for me, I've gone to all the gyms, and all the gym equipment is asking you to be full foot, you know, from toe, busu mm-hmm. ball, endo board, Swiss ball, right? But on a motorcycle, as you see, we use 2.5 inches of it. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking, I'm like, well, why don't we balance on the balls of our feet? 2.5 inches. Mountain bikes and motorcycles are this way. Mm-hmm. So I created these foot pegs on a rubber spring that's pretty much the safest balancing device you can have, because you can't fall off it. Mm-hmm. You know, if you do, it's only 2-3 inches. And it has 100% movement, 360 degree movement at 100% of the time. Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? So you're balancing on your toe, on the balls of your feet, where you should be doing all your, you know, where all your, the beginning of any action, beginning mm-hmm. of any movement starts from, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's why it was important for me to make those things for people to start balancing on their feet, to get their feet to be more functional, more coordinated, because when your feet are uncoordinated, unfunctional, then so is your core. Yeah. The first point of contact from bike to ground is your wheels. I could have a factory 450, you know, Eli's, but if it had worn out tires, bald tires, I could ride a stock bike faster. Yeah. You get what I'm saying? Yeah. So that's the thing, is people put their feet in boots, metal planks, then they come home, they put their feet in carbon fiber planks to go ride a bicycle, then they put their feet in squishy shoes. Your feet just fucking fell asleep, son. You know what I mean? You have 100 different ligaments, tendons, muscles, and joints in your foot. Da Vinci says the foot is the most complex suspension system ever created, mm-hmm. and mechanics will never recreate it. Mm-hmm. And it's true. And so that's why it's so important. That's why I'm so big on, you know, balancing from the balls of your feet, riding from the balls of your feet, and running trails with, you know, those five-finger shoes. Mm-hmm. And it's because, again, that allows you to have more balance, more feel. Mm-hmm. And that's, it's so important, man. It's so important. And now you see people riding more, so much more with their feet. Yeah. Your arms are just pointers. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so hopefully I didn't BG you.
Well, we're good. So, dude, we came into this with a plan that we're going to do two shows.
Yeah.
Because we have so much to talk about. We've known each other so long.
And yeah.
This concludes episode one. Stay tuned for next week for episode two. But we'll be right back for more with Ryan Hughes in a week.